Welcome back. This is the second of two parts of lecture number 15, the last lecture for the semester on the wake of Hegel, Feuerbach, Marx, and Nietzsche. And let's pick up where we left. Once again, Marx channels Hegel on slavery. He also seems to channel Kant on the categorical imperative, although he's asking again a sociological question. What are the consequences of treating people not just as means, but as just as means, but not as ends also? And this brings us to an analysis once again of slavery and freedom, the role of the personal and the impersonal. Wage labor is an example of what Marx, again following Kingsley, calls the cash nexus relationship. Let's say you're my employer, you pay me as a worker a wage. After having paid it, you're both quits. Now the worker may come back, I may come back tomorrow, and the deal is struck anew. But each party is completely free to agree to renew the relationship or to refuse. So for example, what if tomorrow there's no more work? Well, the worker's out of a job. And because yesterday's cash nexus exhausted the relationship between employer and employee, the boss doesn't owe the worker anything, doesn't owe him continued employment. The worker's out of a job, that's one outcome, but also the worker may quit, just as the boss is free not to renew the contract, so the worker is free not to, or to terminate it at any point. Because the boss does not own the worker's labor, that's what it means to have wage labor, free wage labor, as opposed to slavery. The worker's labor is formally free to him to sell to the boss if he chooses. Likewise, the boss is free for whatever reason to refuse to buy the worker's labor power today, tomorrow, or that matter, any point in the future. The contract can be renewed again and again and again, or it could be terminated at any time. Now, in ordinary language, we use the metaphor of slavery to refer to this relationship. We talk about wage slavery. It's true that slavery is among the set of miserable work conditions, but it also does differ from wage labor, however miserable that too might become. The slave laborer in the garment industry today, this is actually a picture of someone who is in that situation, can't just send the boss a postcard, go into karaoke and sing, take this job and shove it. On a scale of slavery to sex, which we examined before in the previous lecture, where slavery is purely a one-way transaction and sex should be reciprocal, not only two-way, but reciprocal. Wage labor is not, like slavery, 100% transactional, but there is some imbalance, at least in Marx's view, between the boss using the wage labor simply as a means instrumentally and not also as an end. The Dilbert cartoon, the boss says, "We're buying an entire company just to get their engineers." Dilbert asks him, "Are you aware that slavery is illegal and that the engineers are free to find jobs at better companies?" I sure hope you're wrong about that. Well, he is. He's not, he's right about that. The obvious difference between free labor and slave labor is that free workers are not owned. They're at liberty to change jobs, but on the other hand, they're not owed either. In a slave relationship, the master owns the slave's labor power. In a free wage labor situation, the boss merely rents that labor power. So basically, what we call wage slaves might be better thought of as rent boys or rent girls. The cash nexus is, to this extent, a social relation of freedom without any other bondage or obligation attached, except that to which the parties may agree in an ongoing way or may cease to agree at some point. What's called the sharing gig economy, this is the word sharing, you know. This takes the whole tendency to a new extreme. Operators are not employees, and therefore they don't get even the few benefits that employees do. Instead, they bear the costs. So the largest hotel company in the world has no hotel rooms, Airbnb. The largest taxi company in the world owns no taxis, Uber. The person driving pays for the car note, pays for the insurance, pays for everything else, takes the amortization, the company possibly takes the profits. This is, as Noam Chomsky suggests, a sort of general principle. In the exchange relation of wage labor as well as ownership is formally free. Under conditions of slavery, though, on the other hand, Master owns the slave, including the slave's labor power. The slave is not free to sell it to the highest bidder. The slave is not free to change masters if he wants to. He's a slave, after all. That's what slavery means. The free laborer in the working class, however, enjoys the liberty to sell his labor power to any bidder and to change employers at will according to his free choice. At least that is the principle. Now, it seems obvious. It's better to be free than to be enslaved, even if one is free under adverse conditions. On the other hand, since the master owns the slave, the master has certain obligations toward the slave's upkeep that the boss would not have toward the worker. The slave might not be productive this season. Let's say it's winter, there are no crops growing. Maybe the boss finds some work for him. Maybe the slave just waits around until, you know, harvest season, whatever the case may be. But he has to be clothed and fed and kept alive, the slave, until that time comes. Since the slave is his property, the master has a definite self-interest in the welfare. It may be just minimal, but some interest in the welfare of his particular slaves. At least they must not starve. Factory owner, on the other hand, has no such obligation. If it's off season and he can't employ his workers, there's a downturn. Right now, again, I'm speaking from the beginning of the corona pandemic, massive unemployment such as we've never seen since the Great Depression. There's no work, goodbye, say the bosses to the workers. Not my problem. Your problem. The workers are going to have to fend for themselves. And if and when employment picks up again, well, of course, he'll be glad to welcome them back, those who may have survived, or there may be, depending on the labor supply, there may be some new ones to take their place. The law, in its majestic equality, forbids the rich as well as the poor to sleep on their bridges, to beg in the streets, and to steal bread. Yes, the law is the same for everyone, even when economic circumstances may not be. So the formal freedom enjoyed by the wage laborer can be really harsh. The cash nexus is purely transactional, purely instrumental. It's only as good as, what have you done for me today? And there are some countervailing powers that could be brought to bear. Unionization, collective bargaining might provide some modicum of countervailing power, but basically the cash nexus is really transactional and contingent, however, to what extent that may be modified. Marx's buddy Friedrich Engels wrote an interesting book, The Condition of the Working Class in 1844. And Engels, whose family had some ties there in Manchester, examines the free workers in Manchester, the heart of the English Industrial Revolution at the time. And he discovers that materially, at least, the slaves in the American South were better off than the free workers in Manchester, England in 1844. Now, this is not a defense of slavery. I think that's not, was not Engels' intention at all. But I think his point was, at least the damn slaveholders have a material incentive to look out for the welfare of their slaves, whereas under capitalism, the, quote, free workers of Manchester don't enjoy even the meager benefits that slavery might bring. Okay, so that leads to a big question. What would happen if the workers lost their false consciousness? They're getting a raw deal. They're getting the shit end of the stick. Suppose, to go back to Morgan Freeman, suppose Morgan does get wised up to this process by which he's being made a wage slave, and he's alienating his labor in both the sense of externalizing it and also of having it reified, objectified, taken away from him, losing control over it, paid a fraction of what it's worth in the form of a wage, while the boss takes another fraction in the form of profit. Suppose Morgan figures this out. He loses his false consciousness. He comes to realize that the value of what he produces lies entirely in the value of the labor power that he sells to the boss, and that he is being exploited by not being paid the full value, even where, in fact, he may not be strictly cheated. Isn't Morgan going to be very angry? This displeases me. Isn't he going to be on the barricades leading the charge, or at least pulling his head out of his box? This is what Marx thinks is going to happen. As the workers get squeezed increasingly, as wage slaves wake up to the fact that this is happening, they're being exploited, then they will rise up. They will revolt. They will overthrow the capitalist system of production and establish a new order of communist socialism. Under that new order, some basic inequalities and exploitative relationships will be abolished, at least, and replaced with more humanly favorable, equitable ones. Okay, that was Marx's expectation. What happened? What became of the revolt of the exploited workers? Workers of the world unite, said Marx in the Communist Manifesto famously. You have nothing to lose but your chains. This is kind of, you've got to hit rock bottom explanation. And, you know, you hear that, of course, that's, I'm quoting AA there, you know, not until your back is against the wall. And what we've learned about revolutions subsequently is that it isn't the completely immiserated people who are capable of making revolutions. People who make revolutions have suffered relative deprivation recently, and that's what sparks revolt, but rather a different process than what Marx expected. But in any case, experience tells us that not all workers think alike. So here's a worker painting up, graffitiing Marx's slogan, "Workers of the World Unite," and there's a worker coming along behind him with the wherewithal to erase it. Jay Gould, one of the major American robber barons after the Civil War. "I can hire one half of the working class to kill the other half." Sometimes he can. So no matter how bad things get, no matter how desperate we come, don't ever stop believing that together, united, we still have the power to destroy what's left of our social safety net. Sometimes the workers do not act in their own best interest. Marx expected that the revolt of the slaves would happen in his own lifetime or in the near future. Based on his analysis of capitalism and history, he expected it to start in the industrialized countries, like Britain, like France, or possibly even the United States. Here's Eugene Debs, a socialist agitator about a century ago. Here's the Labour Party in Britain. Both of these sites looked ripe for revolution, at least from Marx's point of view. But did the proletariat follow the script? Let me ask a question. Where was the first communist revolution? Question. And the answer is Russia. Well, Russia was an economically backward place. It had little industry. It was dominated by a feudal monarchy, and not a capitalist class. That is the opposite of the conditions Marx expected in order for revolution to occur. But Lenin was a smart boy, and he seized the day. He saw revolt was breaking out for other reasons than perhaps the Marxian ones, but he said, that's okay, we can incorporate that into the overall system. And Marxism-Leninism is the result of that. Question, where was the second big revolution? Answer, China. Another economically backward place with little industry, dominated by a feudal monarchy, not a capitalist class, the opposite of the conditions that Marx expected. Question, where was the third? Answer, Cuba. Economically backward place with little industry, dominated by a comprador bourgeoisie, and being infiltrated by the American mafia, if you've seen The Godfather. Again, the opposite of the conditions that Marx expected. So, Marx, it looks like, is 0 for 3 on the crystal ball. Now, is it entirely fair to Marx to tag him with these failed predictions, text of these failed predictions? After all, he and Hegel thought history was predictable, although Marx, again, I suggest, may not have been quite so strictly deterministic as Hegel. But it was like Yogi says, it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future. Think about, for example, the 1939 New York World's Fair. The World of Tomorrow opened 30th of April, 1939, and it was going to usher in an era of prosperity and great new technology, consumer technology. April 30th, 1939, it opens. September 1st, 1939, the Germans invade Poland. By the time the fair closed in 1940, a lot of the pavilions had to close because the countries represented by those pavilions no longer existed, at least no longer existed in independent form. They had been overrun by Blitzkrieg. And they couldn't see this coming. It was right around the corner. Couldn't see it coming. Some people did. Some people should have, but generally not. So this is typical. We look back in retrospect and the Owl of Minerva spreads its wings and hindsight is 20/20. But so many people never see it coming. And by the way, what are those flying cars that the Jetsons promised us in the future? I think if you find those 40 acres and a mule, you'll probably find the flying cars too. So this raises a question in turn. Is Marx simply passé? Some would say yes. Revolution did not come the way Marx expected, and the revolutions which did come did not bring in the sort of betterment for which people had hoped. That's putting it mildly. Executions in the Soviet Union, massive starvation in China, Mao Zedong presided over the world's worst famine in history in the 1950s, hushed it all up. Lots of suffering and misery, kind of a bad track record. Communism killed 100 million people, and all I got was this lousy t-shirt with Che Guevara on it. So one could say, yeah, you know, Marx, what's the big deal? On the other hand, Terry Eagleton makes a good case for not forgetting Marx in the world in which we live. It's worth quoting him at length here. There's a sense, says Eagleton, in which the whole of Marx's writing boils down to several embarrassing questions. First of all, why is it that the capitalist West has accumulated more resources than human history has ever witnessed, yet appears powerless to overcome poverty, starvation, exploitation, and inequality? Secondly, what are the mechanisms by which affluence for a minority seems to breed hardship and indignity for the many? Number three, why does private wealth seem to go hand in hand with public squalor? Is it, as the good-hearted liberal reformist suggests, that we have simply not got around to mopping up these pockets of human misery, but shall do so in the fullness of time? Or is it more plausible to maintain that there is something in the nature of capitalism itself which generates deprivation and inequality, surely as Charlie Sheen generates gossip? Marx was the first thinker to talk in these terms. This down-at-the-heel emigre Jew, a man who once remarked that nobody had written so much about money and had so little, bequeathed to us the language in which the whole system under which we live could be grasped as a whole. End quote. So if Eagleton's point is to be credited, it's worth reading Marx because his central questions are still open questions. You know, we live in a country, the United States, which still, after all these years, does not have guaranteed health care for its citizens. Russia under Putin is not unlike Britain under the Industrial Revolution in which Marx lived. Some of the same questions still very pertinent. Relatively many people who are still acquainted with Marx are acquainted with Marx, the angry critic of human exploitation and willful stupidity. Capitalism, as he defined it, is a system of production for profit rather than for use. And profit becomes not a means to an end, but an end in itself. Goal displacement takes place, no matter how stupid or destructive the consequences. Well, we see examples of that again in the current pandemic. Farmers having to pour out milk. Hey, you know, they're starving people. They could drink the milk. The milk could be made into cheese. They could be nourished. Exactly the same thing, by the way, happened in the Great Depression. And it does happen when you can't turn a profit on your product. It's wasteful. It's stupid. Marx thinks it's not just accidental that there is a systematic factor at work. It's worth paying attention to what is distinctive about Marx's conception of capitalism. And I said this a little earlier in talking, comparing Marx with Plato way, way, way back in the beginning of the course. For Marx, capitalism isn't defined psychologically as greed. And greed certainly isn't a very recent phenomenon in human history. Capitalism is, so greed's not going to be an explanation for that. Nor is capitalism defined as the news media tends to do. It's gone back to the definition of free enterprise. It is, in Marx's view, rather something different. A system of production for profit rather than for use. So use value takes a back seat to profit. If profit can't be made on all that milk, then it gets dumped rather than used. That's a common occurrence. Marx's main point about capitalism is that it runs as a system with its own inner logic, but the logic is far from rational or optimal. So that's what people remember Marx for. Relatively fewer people remember Marx as the bemused observer of human folly, and he is quite acerbic. One reason to read Marx today is you come away with a keener sense of just how mendacious and self-deceiving people become when they talk about money. Marx's message is, I can tell you're lying. Your lips are moving and the subject is money. That's not a bad rule of thumb. Also, you know, think about Marx's commentary on the slaughter in the Paris Commune. The bourgeoisie of the whole world, he said, which looks complacently upon the wholesale massacre after the battle, is convulsed by horror at the desecration of brick and mortar. The people of Paris rose up in the Paris Commune. They were slaughtered, lined up against the wall and shot. They did some property destruction in the midst of all of this, but that was what a lot of people paid attention to, not the waste of human life. And Marx is really quite, acerbic on this. He says in the Communist Manifesto, the bourgeoisie has put an end to all feudal patriarchal idyllic relations It has pitilessly torn asunder the motley feudal ties that bound man to his, quote, natural superiors, unquote, and has left remaining no other nexus between man and man than naked self-interest than callous cash payment, the cash nexus. It has drowned the most heavenly ecstasies of religious fervor, of chivalrous enthusiasm, of Philistine sentimentalism in the icy water of egotistical calculation. It has resolved personal worth into exchange value. It has rescued a considerable part of the population from the idiocy of rural life. That's not your usual bromide. Few too also recall how Marx comes away just so bitterly disappointed with the gap between the enormous promise of industrialization. You know, it's capable of creating widespread prosperity, and yet at the same time, it's not used to those ends. Private wealth goes hand in hand so readily and thoroughly, as Eagleton puts it, with a public squalor. And Marx is very eloquent again on that as well. I mentioned Bettany Hughes' study of Socrates earlier when we talked about the Greeks. She says, of Socrates, we think the way we did because Socrates thought the way he did. I think Eagles is trying to make the same point from Marx. He gave us the vocabulary and the conceptual framework in terms of which to discuss these issues, and whether or not his substantive views pan out, in some cases they really don't, still worth reading, still worth considering, not just to be forgotten and cast into the dustbin of history. In any case, it's worth noting, despite his own sense of having abolished philosophy, Marx was very much the philosopher. As an economist, he is a philosopher among economists. He was a philosophy major, after all. His economic analysis comes about as a direct application of certain elements of philosophy, particularly as we've seen from Hegel and specifically via Feuerbach. Marx's emphasis on labor comes from Hegel's dialectic of master and slave in the Phenomenology. The process Marx sees in the formation of profit comes from Feuerbach's analysis of religion. Unlike many in the philosophical tradition, but unlike the typical economist, Marx is attuned to the workings of false consciousness. Most economists don't treat that subject at all. And again, like Hegel, Marx sees the process as one of conflict and struggle, endemic class conflict. Whereas the received wisdom among professional economists is that the economy is an arena of cooperation and calm, rational choice, and trying to find satisfactory solutions to all problems. Furthermore, note that as an economist, Marx differs from most technical economists in that he sees his economic analysis as connected to a broader analysis of society, an account of human nature, and an account of the relations of power. This is, again, because Marx started as a philosophy major after the manner of Hegel. That's why he writes as distinctively as he does about the subject of economics in ways that others typically do not. Marx looked forward and saw the revolt of the slaves, thought the revolt of the wage slaves would happen soon. Nietzsche looks not forward, but backward. Nietzsche thinks that the slave revolt has happened already, and it happened a long time ago. And Nietzsche thought this in part because he had a very expanded idea of what power is. So let's turn to Nietzsche and consider what he has to say. In Thus Spoke Zarathustra, Nietzsche said this: where I found the living, I found the will to power. And even in the will of those who serve, I found the will to be master. Remember Max Weber's definition of power, the ability to realize one's will even in the face of resistance. So if I try to do something and bulldoze through, and I bulldoze you out of the way, to that extent I exercise power over you, to the extent that you stop my bulldozing, to that extent you exercise power over me, and I do not exercise power to the same extent. How many different pathways, though, are there to realize one's will in the face of opposition? There are some people who claim they have no power. There are some people who claim they want no power. Think about Pierre Proudhon, for example, one of the founding anarchists. He came up with the symbol which the anarchists still use, the letter A circumscribed by the letter O. Anarchy is order without power, so there's no letter P in there. It's possible to have a political order without power relationships. Nietzsche very much doubts this. He doubts that there is anyone who does not want power in some way or another. Every human being, indeed every living being, seeks power over any other. It's just that some are direct and some are sneaky. which leads to a key concept in Nietzsche's analysis, ressentiment, resentment. The easiest way is to express power, of course, to do so openly. If and when expression of power becomes thwarted, it doesn't just disappear, it goes underground, the return of the repressed, as Freud discussed. For Nietzsche, morality is a chief instance of the return of the repressed, thwarted will to power in an indirect way. For Nietzsche, morality expresses the resentment of those who have been defeated and whose will to power has been thwarted of the broken weak against the victorious strong. Morality, in other words, becomes weaponized. Von Clausewitz famously defines war as the continuation of policy by other means. Joël Lai modifies this. Diplomacy is the continuation of war by other means. Nietzsche thinks that morality is a continuation of power struggle by other means. The use of guilt is a particularly important strategy. So let's consider the operation of passive aggression. Certainly there are people who claim they don't want to dominate others. Nietzsche would say, and I'm paraphrasing here, Sir Peter Medawar, who has a wicked tongue and is well worth reading also. Such people may be excused from the charge of intellectual dishonesty only on the grounds that before setting out to deceive the rest of the world, they first deceived themselves. One important way in which people achieve interpersonal power is to disguise it as passivity and mildness. People who claim not to want power might eschew direct aggression, yes, but they still have passive aggression in their toolkit. Passive aggression, isn't that an interesting term? It's kind of like learned helplessness. Huh? It's possible to learn helplessness. If you look at passive aggressive in the dictionary, you get these scary DSM definitions about, you know, psychiatric conditions and so forth. But there are more normal and widespread ways, what perhaps Freud meant when he refers to the psychopathology of everyday life. And we see passive aggressiveness in operation around us all the time. Here are a couple of examples. The stereotype of the Jewish mother. Mother dominates son while pretending to be meek and mild. And there's a certain sort of male-female relationship in which the woman dominates while pretending to be dominated and downtrodden. Now, we know or should know already, there is no such thing as a Jewish mother. All mothers are like this. They all nag. They all instill guilt. It's just that Jewish kids are more vocal about it. So it is a matter of differential communication. Rather than an actual difference. That's precisely why I think the idea of the Jewish mother resonates so well in non-Jewish subcultures as well as the Jewish subcultures. The stereotypical Jewish mother, she's a stock figure of comedy from post-World War II, stand-up shtick and so forth. And she dominates her children, she dominates her husband also while stage acting the part of a poor, powerless creature who just wants the best already. Gertrude Berg, the radio comedian, did some bits on this, and Dan Greenberg put this in book form in 1965, How to Be a Jewish Mother. Well, one of her monologues goes this way. First, you buy your son, Marvin, two shirts. When he wears one, you say, what's the matter? The other one you didn't like? And this immediately wrongfoots Marvin. No matter what he does, he's damned if he does, damned if he doesn't. It's a classic double bind. Greenberg defined the Jewish mother as, quote, an expert at instilling guilt and manipulating, end quote. Jewish mothers are a bottomless pit of neediness, but they're indirect about it. They get what they want, while at the same time denying what they want. Another comedian, Jack Carter, had a bit on this. You can never give Jewish mothers gifts. They always resist it. Eventually they take it, but they fight you. I wanted to give my mother a fur coat. Don't spend the money. You'll never wear it. I don't need a fur coat. Maybe a mink would be nice. A small one. And all the stand-up comedy about Jewish mothers and their passive-aggressive manipulation could have come straight out of Nietzsche. Mom pretends to be meek and mild, all the while she is running son's life, particularly by instilling and playing on guilt. You never call. You never write. Mrs. Einstein did this to her son, Albert. He wanted to marry a fellow student. Albert, she says, if you marry that girl, it'll give me a nervous breakdown. I will spend the rest of my life in bed and it will be your fault. Moral bullying, the passive aggressive weapon of choice. Now, in order to use this, you don't have to be Jewish or a mother. It's perfectly general. Consider passive aggressive street signs. Fine, don't stop, whatever. No one's going to make you yield. It's your life. Most people think there's no turn on red, but maybe you're just different. You know? Stop sign is stoptional. Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, people send passive aggressive notes. Here's passive aggressiveness at work. One colleague says to the other, "Your social media presentation to the board was quite good, Tom." "What do you mean quite good?" "Oh, the info you gave us was so relevant. You had us in the palm of your hand. Thanks." None of us fell asleep this time. Yeah. Damning with faint praise, as it were. Some people talk through their animals. Is he a bad man? Is he a bad doctor who's going to hurt you? Yes, he is. He's a bad man, evil. He's the devil spawn of Satan who's going to hurt my Pookie Wookie. Okay. He gets the message. Wait, is that her? I'm supposed to notice she's annoyed face, or is she just tired? What's today's penalty for asking? Oh, God. And then there's this one. "Well, yes, Your Honor, I did murder my parents, but have mercy. I'm a poor orphan." And if you ever get caught sleeping on the job, here's what you do. And God bless the boss. Amen. What's he going to say? That being said, passive-aggressive domination can be the stock repertoire also of male-female conflict. Here's an interesting book from, I think, the 90s, The Rules. Time-tested secrets for capturing the heart of Mr. Right. With Fine and Schneider. And, oh, they have lots of rules. Hmm? Don't talk to a man first and don't ask him to dance. Don't call him and rarely return his calls. Always end phone calls and dates first. Don't accept a Saturday night date after Wednesday. Always end the date first. Don't see him more than once or twice a week. Let him take the lead. Don't tell him what to do. Be easy to live with, etc., etc. Appear passive. Number 16. Don't tell him what to do. Of course not. That would go away the game. Number 17. Let him take the lead. Dumb schmuck. He just thinks he's in charge. But don't really be passive. You know? Make him court and pay homage to you. Then call the shots. Numbers 5 and 7 and 11. Make him call you, then don't return his calls. If you deign to take his call, end it first. Don't let him ask you out at the last minute at his convenience. Remember Serge Gainsbourg? We listened to his song with the duet with Jeanne Beck and Oui, je t'aime moi non plus. The party who's most indifferent is the party in charge. We talked about that vis-a-vis Hegel. Here it is once again. Well, perhaps there are worse rules. I hate to have this in my wallet. You are not to have a single girl's phone number. You are not to follow them on any social media. You are not to hang out with Keegan. You are not to go to Honda without me. You are not to hang out. Wow. Okay. Goodbye. The authors of the rules were criticized in that one doesn't count and the other's a freelance journalist. So they're not professional psychologists. They don't have credentials, etc. But I mean, this criticism is the point. Their subtitle is, as you'll notice, Time-Tested Secrets. And these are time-tested. These are very, very old. In fact, maybe the oldest literary version is the Canterbury Tales, The Wife of Bath. Put the husbands in the wrong. A knowing wife, if she is worth her salt, can always prove her husband is at fault, right? The wife of Bath has had five husbands, and she tells the tale of how she got through this. She smacked each husband down psychologically, so he knew from the outset that she was the boss. She did her wifely duty and kept each sexually satisfied, so he stayed with her and under her thumb. And she let it be known that she suspected him of infidelity so as to put him off guard and unaware of her infidelity. That's a classic tactic. Always accuse the other party of what you're, in fact, doing on the side. Quis custodiet ipsos custodius juvenal in the satires. If your wife is philandering, lock her up and set a guard. Problem with this is a smart wife is going to anticipate this. She's going to do the guard so the guard doesn't tell who else she's doing. This sort of passive aggressiveness is not incompatible with having a big chip on your shoulder, Coco Chanel, to this point. As long as you know men are like children, you know everything. But in fairness to Coco, she was an equal opportunity misanthrope. About women, she said, a woman equals envy plus vanity plus chatter plus a confused mind. We talked again in thinking about Hegel, about Bruno Bettelheim and the identification with the aggressor that he observed in concentration camps. American men seem to be prone to demonstrate there can also be identification with the passive aggressor. So when a guy does something wrong, here's how it plays out. She says, "You broke my favorite lamp." It was an accident. I didn't mean to. I can't believe you did this. I'm sorry. And when a girl does something wrong, you lost my dog? It was an accident. I didn't mean to. I can't believe you did this. I already feel bad about it. Stop making me feel worse. I'm sorry. Gas station mendicants can try to appear humble with a big chip on their shoulders and psychological weaponry. You refuse them a handout and you get, God bless you. Have a good day, sir. You know, one of those ways in which someone can say, sir, make it rhyme with gur and mean F you. And I was wondering, why is it that these guys have a direct hotline to the creator of the universe that they are delegated to dispense God's blessings? They seem to think often that they are. So passive doesn't necessarily imply non-aggressive. Nietzsche sees passive aggressiveness as just one alternate explanation of the will to power, an indirect form rather than a direct one. Weakness and meekness are not goodness for Nietzsche, though often they are mistaken for such. Playing nice can just be one more way of playing nasty. And Nietzsche says this, we considered this earlier vis-a-vis Kant, who says something not disorder. Nietzsche says this, of all evil, I deem you the powerful capable. Therefore, I want the good from you. Verily, I've often laughed at the weaklings who thought themselves good because they had no claws. Nietzsche's point is that whether directly aggressive or simply passively aggressive, everyone pursues the will to power. For the passive aggressive, morality and guilt has proven a potent weapon in the struggle for interpersonal power. So let's look at how this works out. Resentment and the slave revolt in morality that Nietzsche describes. We've seen this cartoon before. Ethics of a certain sort carries passive aggressiveness to the level of class warfare. Yeah, we talked about this with Hegel. Anybody notice how Hegel's account of the dialectic of mastery and slavery is just so cerebral and bloodless? The slaves don't directly revolt. What happens is the whole process of interaction carries forward by its own dialectical logic and turns the tables, although neither the master nor the slave is aware at the time this is happening, much less in charge of the process. But is that how slaves would really work things out? Wouldn't they really be pissed off? Wouldn't they want revenge? But in Hegel's account, they don't. The slave does not revolt against the master. He does overcome the master, but that's a different thing. So Hegel's slave is not Nat Turner. Hegel's slave is not Toussaint Louverture and the Haitian slave revolt and so forth. But if the slaves were angry, would they dare express this openly? They might slip ground glass in the master's stew. They might urinate in his wine. These were actually tactics that slaves in North America did. Minnie Jackson's chocolate pie, if you know the film The Help, that ain't chocolate, not chocolate pie. I'll spoiler alert. Passive-aggressive revenge of this sort would be limited. It wouldn't change much. On the other hand, if you revolt openly, what does it get you? Think about Spartacus. How's that going for him? Didn't turn out so well. Despite what Hegel says about the master becoming the slave of the slave and the slave becoming the master of the master, at the end of the day, master is still top and slave is still bottom. But in Nietzsche's story, there's a third party that makes a big difference, and that is the priest. The priest intervenes between the raging slave and the object of his hatred, the master. The priest, first of all, does two things. First of all, he calms the slave, teaches him to hide one face behind another, and diverts him from direct revenge. But hate is a potent force, and the priest knows how to use it. Second thing the priest does is to sublimate the seething rage and hate of the slave, and the cleverest of revenges, one the masters never see coming. So slave aggression, in Nietzsche's view, is indirect. Their revolt may be passive-aggressive, but it doesn't mean it's not aggressive. In Nietzsche's story, the slaves remain in the background. The slave revolt in morality is spearheaded by an intermediary, the priest, though acting on their behalf. So the slaves are sheep, but they follow their shepherd, their pastor. Notice, by the way, the language, that religious language that we use, tacos al pastor, shepherder's tacos, basically. The pastor and the flock of sheep. But the pastor, however, only looks like one of the sheep in Nietzsche's tale. And Nietzsche is very savage about the subjects of the priesthood. Priests work undercover They're sneaky and they work by poison. And I would comment something that's often not said about Nietzsche's analysis of the priest. He doesn't talk in any denominational terms. He talks about the figure of the priest, but it seems to me it's not merely the social position of the priest as a religious leader that makes the slave revolt happen. Not every priesthood manages to pull it off. The substance of the priesthood's ideas matter too. For example, the notion of sin. This disarms the flock. It says, you know, sure, you're suffering, my sheep, but it's your own damn fault. Ideas like the Sermon on the Mount give the priest symbolic resources, as we'll see, to displace the old master morality. So it seems to me that lurking behind, it's the Christian priesthood in particular that becomes especially effective in Nietzsche's tale. The good shepherd handles the wounded slave first by poisoning his wound and turning aggression inward, teaching him the doctrine of sin. Yes, my sheep, you suffer, but it is you who have caused your own suffering by your own sins. You know, this is something you've brought upon yourself. It is self-inflicted. The result is to divert the aggression inward toward themselves instead of the master, but this saves their lives and allows the priest then to continue his work, which is, as Nietzsche calls it, the transvaluation of all values. So next, on behalf of the slaves, the priest attacks the masters by poisoning the wells. You really hate me, don't you? The priest brings about a reversal of their value system so as to make the masters internalize alien values. Remember the discussion of Franz Fanon and mental colonization. That's exactly what's at work here. Avant la lettre. In light of which then the masters adopt the slavish view of morality, coming to despise the master in life, coming to hate themselves. I think I noted previously, Marx is generally taken for an economist, though he trained in philosophy. Nietzsche is often taken for a philosopher, though he trained in something else, philology, what we would call linguistics. And in his work on the genealogy of morals, where he analyzes this transvaluation of values, he begins with a linguistic observation. Nietzsche notes that there are two antonyms for good. It could be good versus bad or good versus evil. And in a variety of languages, including ancient languages, the good-bad opposition is the older opposition, and then the good-evil opposition comes about later. What seems to happen is that the moral quality is designated bad, as I'll call this bad superscript one, become the qualities of the new good, superscript two, while the qualities of the old good, good superscript one, are now displaced and come to define evil, superscript two. In other words, values are transvalued. And what are those qualities? Well, Nietzsche notes that at first, the moral qualities of virtue and vice were social class-based. And this is interesting because in our way of thinking of morality, modern way of thinking of morality, virtues and vices are not social class-based. They're thought to be abstract and universal. So for example, I could say, the president is a good man, or I could say the president is a bad man. And I'm not contradicting myself in either case, because the president is good or the president is bad, neither of those two things are thought to be analytic propositions. And again, this goes back to our discussion of those way early in the course. Now, I might be correct or I might be incorrect if I say the president is a good man or a bad man, factually, but that's another matter. These are thought to be at least synthetic propositions, and they could be true, they could be false, and we have to bring some evidence to bear and debate it. This is not the way in which the terms worked initially. To be virtuous was to be noble. And note that the word noble has two very different meanings. To be noble is to be a member of the upper crust, the nobility. To be noble is also to be morally good. To be base and vicious, though, was to be ignoble. To be morally bad was to be lower class, not noble, below the nobility. Originally, goodness comprises the noble virtues of the aristocratic orders, the lordly masters. Think about Achilles and the Homeric warriors. We discussed that briefly vis-a-vis Socrates before. Beauty and strength, daring or pride, for example, these are the masterly virtues. Badness comprises the vices associated with the lower orders, the slaves, meekness, fear, deference, serving others, etc. There's an interesting incident in the Iliad, and you see this dramatized in the film Troy. King Agamemnon at the left wants to steal the slave girl Briseis from Lord Achilles, who is, and by the way, when these soldiers went to war, they didn't get paid money, they got booty They got treasure and women and slaves, all these sorts of things together. And Briseis has been given to Achilles, but Agamemnon wants to take her. Now, the question in the Iliad here is not at all that Agamemnon might somehow become morally bad if he steals or enslaves. If he's strong enough, he gets what he wants, that's good. That's what masters do. Whatever masters do, by definition, is good. So unlike our way of looking at things, for Homer, power, lordship, strength are just identical, analytically so. And they're identical with moral goodness, agathos, as the Greeks put it. Alistair MacIntyre has an interesting analysis of this in his book, A Short History of Ethics. He comments on this incident in the Iliad. This incident brings out the divorce of agathos in the Homeric poems from the later uses of good, including later uses of agathos. When Agamemnon intends to steal the slave girl, Briseis, from Achilles, Nestor says to him, "Do not, agathos, though you be, take the girl from him." This is not a moral counsel, this is a counsel of prudence. It is not that being agathos, Agamemnon can be expected not to take the girl, nor that he will cease to be agathos if he does not take her. He will be agathos whether he takes her or not. The question is, if he takes her, they're going to fight each other, and they should be fighting the common enemy. So it's a pragmatic consideration at hand, not what we would regard as a moral one. What it means to be good is so thoroughly bound to the upper status of being a lord that an utterance like King Agamemnon is bad would, for Homer and his audience, have the logical status of saying something like this circle is square. Unlike our, we could say the president is good or the president is bad. If you say the king is bad, you have said circles are squares, in effect, logically. And that's a huge, huge, huge difference between the way they looked at morality and the way that we do. We, on the other hand, associate moral terms like good and bad only contingently with social status and rank, and not necessarily not analytically so. So, for example, in 1977, I remember seeing this. It was in a bar in Tallahassee. I was a student at Florida State. And David Frost interviews Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon has now been deposed from the presidency for several years, trying to make a comeback. And Nixon tells Frost about some of the Watergate shenanigans. "Well, when the president does it, it is not illegal." Everybody's jaws drop, including Frost. Hey, if there's a recent film about this, Frost and Nixon, you can see that dramatized. It's astounding. Nixon is asserting the divine right of kings, that whatever the king does, by definition, is morally good without question. Of course, we have heard that for centuries before. There's a current guy, he lives in a place called Mar-a-Lago North, you may have heard. He seems to do more or less the same thing, but it's just as shocking. It's kind of rare anymore. Good, agathos, as the Greeks called it, is conceived in social class terms as the lordly, masterly virtues. Agamemnon just is agathos, by definition. It has nothing to do with the acts that he does. If he steals, he doesn't cease to be agathos. It has everything to do with his social status as lord and king. Now, this comes to change. For Homer, might is right, analytically so. If I'm strong and powerful and noble, I can do what I want to do, and there's no law outside of me that could tell me otherwise. Nowadays, we think of moral qualities, goodness and badness, as contingently relating to the people they are ascribed. So we might say this person is good, or this person is bad, and either of those things could be true, depending on evidence. So our very idea of morality has changed from the time of the Homeric ethics until subsequent centuries. This is precisely what Nietzsche wants to explain. How did this ever happen? If agathos is noble, its opposite is ignoble. Remember Socrates when he's giving the speech after he's been condemned to death while they're preparing to take him off to prison. He tells his accusers that wickedness is swifter than death. You know, you've sentenced me to death and you've sentenced yourself to wickedness and you will fall to the swifter pursuer. The word that gets translated in English as wickedness is a bit of a bowdlerization. And again, this is a review for those who heard the Socrates lecture. The word is ponerion, which is from a root word meaning slavishness and labor by sweat. So from that point of view, see these people here laboring in the fields, they are very wicked, bad people. We would say, no, we don't know anything about them. They could be good. They could be bad. They're just working class guys, you know, out in the field doing their thing. No. For Homer, this is moral badness because it's lower class. Within the aristocratic Homeric value system, there was hardly a worse insult than to call someone a worker. you said they were low down, they were churlish, they were knaves. These are all class-based terms. They were low life. That's all kind of wrapped up together. Do you get a sense of the aristocratic virtues that Nietzsche sees as coming under attack? Let's watch a short clip from the film Gladiator. General Maximus, played by Russell Crowe, is coming up to the Battle of Vindobonum, and you'll see there's a cameo, not cameo, there's a short bit there with the emperor on horseback watching all this. The emperor was Marcus Aurelius, who was also a philosopher. But Maximus, of course, fictional character, but his characterization, I think, embodies the kind of thing that Nietzsche thinks was going to be disappeared. Let's have a look.
People should know when they're conquered.
Yes, so this is an example of a lordly ethic, strength and honor. Like Achilles, General Maximus embodies this pre-Christian aristocratic lordly ethic. So how does it work that this disappears? Here's how it worked at first, when the opposite of good was bad. So good, superscript one, the lordly virtues, joy, pride, strength, victory, excellence, beauty, risk-taking, bravery, generosity, hedonism, self-seeking, aggressiveness. And the vices, the bad, were slavish vices. Fear of the Lord, self-mortification, beauty is vanity, pride goeth before a fall, and a hearty spirit before destruction. Blessed are the meek, turn the other cheek, obedience, humility, stewardship, altruism. He who serves his fellows is of all his fellows greatest, pacifism. Then the priest arrives, and he shoves the lordly vices into the evil column instead, and shoves the slavish virtues into the good column. Now we put a superscript two on there, because the good as defined by the priest is very different from the good as defined previously. So the process works like this, three stages. Lordly virtues are good, slavish vices are bad, then the lordly vices of lordly virtues become the lordly vices defining evil, and the slavish vices become the slavish virtues defining the new idea of good, and matters are in place. Notice, by the way, Nietzsche applies the same sort of analysis as Feuerbach. And Feuerbach said famously, by his God thou knowest the man, and by the man his God, for the two are identical. And Nietzsche says basically, by the slavish virtues thou knowest a slavish life. If you want to understand how slavish virtues came about, look to the form of life out of which they arise. Now, if Nietzsche is correct, then all this happened quite some time ago. Marx is waiting for the slaves to revolt, the wage slaves. Nietzsche says the train's already left the station. Not only did the slaves revolt, but under the leadership of the priests, the slaves won. Nietzsche pinpoints Judaism to a lesser extent, its successor religion, Christianity, to a greater extent, as the vehicles for this transvaluation of all values. The older pre-Christian pagan religions were masterly. Christianity is slavish. This propaganda poster, my God has a hammer, your God was nailed to a cross. Any questions? Think about the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the meek, turn the other cheek, etc. This exalts all the slavish virtues. And here's Jesus' oft-forgotten sermon on passive aggression. If your neighbor strikes you, turn the other cheek. Then your neighbor feels like a total dick. Now, there's a problem with this. If, in fact, you follow out Nietzsche's train of thought, Jesus' cartoon sermon on the Mount here of passive aggression would have been impossible. For exactly the same reason, for instance, as we've seen, that Durkheim finds it impossible to think that society begins in a social contract. Social contract has to pre-exist, the idea of social contract has to pre-exist its use. It can't just arise spontaneously. There has to be an idea there in place first. Likewise, Christianity had first to create that culture in which the sort of appeal to guilt would work. You could make somebody feel like a dick passive aggressively only if they first have it in their mind that that's how they have the idea in their mind that that's how they're supposed to behave, that somehow constitutes goodness and moral virtue. It's not just a pre-existing human condition that people could be shamed the way they are in this cartoon. That's an achievement that has to be created. That, I think, in part is Nietzsche's point. And here's another take on turning the other cheek. The journalist Kavanaugh from Shari Ebdo, no relation to me as far as I can tell, the names are similar. Si ayant frappé ton prochain sur une joue, il te tend l'autre, frappez-le sur la même. Ça lui apprendra à faire le malin. If having slapped your neighbor in the other cheek, he turns the other and the cheek he turns the other cheek, slap it too. It'll wise him up to the ways of the world. Humble brag, we see this all the time. I started my vegetarianism for health reasons, and then it became a moral choice, and now it's just to annoy people. Again, morality as the continuation of power struggle by other means. And consider, it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. Book of Matthew, Gospel of Matthew. Masters who buy into this changed moral outlook are experiencing that mental colonization we talked about before. Just as with colonials who are made to feel inferior, black people are made to feel that non-straight hair is bad and ugly, they too must experience a certain self-loathing. So the priest gets into the master's head and whispers those things about which the master most cares are really definitive of moral evil. So that once things like meekness, turning the other cheek, humility, obedience, pride, growth before a fall, etc., come to be seen as moral virtues, and that again has to be achieved, well, once that is achieved, what Nietzsche calls the slave morality, slave revolt in morality is complete. Strength and honor is gone. Blessed are the meek is here. Nietzsche, incidentally, was the son of a Lutheran clergyman. He did have some respect for Jesus personally. He said in Thus Spake Zarathustra, Jesus died too early. He himself would have recanted his teaching had he reached my age. Noble enough was he to recant, but he was not yet mature. So Marx lived long enough to say, I am not a Marxist, disavow his followers. Apparently Jesus, according to Nietzsche, did not. So he has a little respect for Jesus, but for Christianity as a whole, Nietzsche has nothing but contempt. and the Christians have generally returned the compliment. Nietzsche, also famous for coining the phrase, the death of God. And that's what people often remember most about Nietzsche. But of course, he had much more to say, especially on the topic of religion. Today, most of us are not slaves to lords, well, maybe to landlords. We don't address people as lord, at least in this country we don't. Nor do we tend sheep for a living. But Nietzsche invites us to notice how much our religious language owes to experiences of an older world, to the feudal politics of overlordship, and my Lord and my God, Jesus is Lord. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. The original apostles referred to Jesus as master. This could mean teacher also, but it could mean, you know, literally master. St. Paul certainly calls himself a bond slave of Christ and makes that explicit. The sheep metaphor, again, the pastor leads his flock. I am the good shepherd. Our language embodies that older way of looking at things. Marx was very political. Nietzsche was entirely apolitical. Nonetheless, I think one can read some political implications from Nietzsche's criticism of the sheep metaphor as popularized by Christianity. A French election poster, La majorité, c'est vous. Vous voulez, vous choisiez. The majority, it's you. You want, you should choose. So we've heard now from the philosophy reservoir dogs. In the end, Marx leaves us with hope for a future that would not happen. Nietzsche leaves us with regret for a past which did happen. Might one not wish for something a little more operatic, a little less closure? Well, that is the end of my course of lectures on philosophy for this semester. I hope it's been enjoyable, and I wish you a good day.